your time, young man.
We're filming for Community ITV. We're at Open the Gate in Dalston. And we're here with the wonderful Junior Giscombe.
Hi, Junior.
How are you doing, Natalie?
I'm good, thank you. So, where have you been all these days? What have you been up to?
Oh, wow. Still been working, still been making music. I have a new album which we've just put up on reverbnation.com, everybody. Stroke Junior Giscombe, go up and listen to it. It'll be downloadable in 3 weeks' time, and then it'll actually be released mid-November. It's the first project I've done in 5 years, so I'm really, really proud and pleased of it.
Excellent, excellent. Are you also, have you got a website? Are you on Twitter or anything like that? Find you.
You can find me, people. I have my own website, juniagiscombe.co.uk. You can also get me on Facebook. Right, I'm up there. I don't do Twitter and I don't do the rest because it takes up too much time. And also, I don't really like the fact of continually talking about yourself to people and what you're doing on a daily basis. It seems very egotistical to me. I don't fully get it, you know?
You're from the old school, really.
Very much so, very much so.
So, Junior, I mean, most people would know you from Mama Used to Say, and that's to name a few. Tell us, what's the other track that is a well-known track that people know?
I've been very fortunate. I've had Mama, as you said. I had Too Late, Omens, Morning Will Come, Do You Really Want My Love from the Beverly Hill Cop soundtrack, the very first one. I'm very proud of that because I'm the only English person who was involved in that movie. And the movie did have a tour in it, doing TV, bits and pieces like that. And also for me, I was hungry for knowledge, so I wanted to know more about what Black America was about. I wanted to know how the Caribbean interacted with America. I wanted to know how my music was being accepted during that period of time and looked upon as being, at the time, most people thought I was American because they've not heard British music.
Actually, I thought you was as well. I was surprised when I heard that you wasn't.
Most people say that. I think most probably because of the fact that the style of the music that I make, it seems to be more indicative of the style of music that comes out of America. But Mama changed things when it came out in America. When I went on to do things like Only Knees, which was the beginning of swing, it was the first thing that came out that was a swing-orientated piece of music. Became huge in America, and Teddy Riley then took it on and took it to the next level, where everybody went crazy with swing beat in the 90s. But what it was for me was that coming from England, we were listening to so much different music. My parents, we were listening to reggae music. My dad loved jazz, which is my first love. So jazz music. So
all those different music influence your style, because I know that, you know, it's hard to break into the music industry as a Black person in the UK, so that influenced your style for what you was doing?
Very much so, yeah, very much so. I started out with a band. I put a band together when I was 16, came out of college, went to college, put a band together and we were called Atlantis, and six-piece band. I was really influenced by an album that came out by the Isley Brothers called 3+3, which had a song on it called Who's That Lady, which was in, I think, 1971, 72. But that record was the beginning of what was then going to be called like rock soul and rock R&B, because Ernie Isley played rock guitar, but the groove was still very much R&B. And everybody in England at the time, and that would be like from your 1142s to your High Tensions to your Light the World, those bands, they were doing what was called jazz funk, which was more in keeping with things coming out of America from the jazzier end of it. Bob James, people like that, Harvey Mason, who were doing jazz, mixing it with R&B. And I'd always wanted to make music that was not the same as everybody else. So for me, I took to the Isley Brothers because the Isley Brothers, they stood out like a sore thumb, but in a good way. And the band that I had, which was a 60s realist singing, and I had a guitarist, a bass player, and a drummer. So it was really rock orientated, but with R&B. And we used to play around in those days. We used to play places with the venue. We then did a lot of, funny enough, a lot of reggae clubs during that period of time. And what was good for me was that all of those clubs, I used to go to clubs like that. And there was no way any soul man was going to come in there and sing. So for us to have the front to actually go in and do songs which weren't cover songs, they were original songs. We were actually doing songs that we had written, right?
And all your songs are...
I've done some covers. I've done, on my new album, I've done a version of a great song by Sam Cooke called A Change Is Gonna Come.
Oh,
you know that song?
Yeah, I love that song.
Well, go up on reverbnation.com and you can hear it. I've done a version of that. In the past, I had a hit with Then Came You, which was a song by Dionne Warwick and the Detroit Spinners. I also did a what they call Northern Soul anthem called All Over the World, which was done, I think it was J.J. Barnes who done that, and that was a huge hit as well.
You sound like you're very inspired by a lot of Motown music as well.
Yeah, I mean, to be totally honest with you, I'm inspired by music. I'm a fan of good music. I love it all. I have an affinity to jazz because that's my first love. My dad, my uncles used to play jazz all the time. But at the same time, my two older brothers, they came from Trenchtown. So they lived in the same yard as Bob Marley. So when I was a kid and Bob was living here, I got the chance to meet Bob, know Bob, hear the music and stuff like that. So I have a real cross section. There was my brothers were also in a band, and they had a hit back in the day. They were called the Three Crowns, and they had a hit.
I've heard them before. They sound familiar.
Way back, and they had a track out called Jerk in the Night, I think it was, and they had a hit in Germany. So as a kid, my mum allowed me to go with them and go to Germany and watch them perform and stuff. They also had some friends who didn't live too far from us, and they used to come and rehearse in the house. And their first record was a big tune called Hogging Up a Big Mom. Man. They did that. So as a kid growing up, music from all kinds of different areas, right, was what I was hearing, what was getting.
Yeah, this what makes you a little bit different, I suppose, with your music and travelling, where you had to do what you had to do to get out there, really.
And then by the time I'm like 16, I know that, like, right, I don't want to make music that sounds like that person. I want to make music that sounds like me. So we go through 16, 18, I disband the band. I decided that I needed to learn more about being in the studio. So I got together with a young man called Junior Douglas, who was making an album but didn't have a singer and didn't know how to write lyrics. So he got in contact and we wrote a song. I wrote a song called Get Up and Dance, Hot Up and Heated. The record company that we were signed to was a record company called, it was called Pressure. And Pressure was a subsidiary of a label called Arawak, which was a very big reggae label.